Bill Gates once said you need three things to escape poverty: healthcare, education, and opportunity. This morning, we focus on education. Philippine Business for Education, or PBEDS Director Justin Laagas, welcome back to the program. Justin, hi.
Hi, good morning.
Good morning. So let's start with this, the state of education today, public schools in particular. How do you think we're doing as a nation, and where do you think we could use maybe a little help?
So I'll be very upfront about it. We are in a learning crisis. Children today are really coming to school unprepared to learn because they are hungry. Since 2001, one out of three five-year-olds have been stunted or too short for their age. And that means, you know, they come to school, they're not ready to learn. Even as they age and they progress, they're not able to really absorb what's being taught to them. And this is really due to a lot of conditions. Food insecurity, low family income, mother's education. Aside from that, we are also lagging behind in terms of assessment. We rank lowest in terms of science, mathematics, and reading. And 72% of 15-year-olds are low achievers in reading, math, and science. So it's really a problem, Nona. Students are coming to school unprepared at various levels and different ages, and they're not really learning what they're supposed to be learning. So this situation is so serious, and that's why when you ask, like, what help can be given, we are really calling to convene the EDCOM 2, or the Congressional Commission, which will really review our education system. The president himself said in his inauguration speech that we need to rethink how our schools how we teach in our schools, what the materials are, particularly on basic subjects such as the sciences, in numeracy and literacy, and also in tech voc learning. So the biggest help that we can really do is this EDCOM 2, because it will review the current gaps in our system at the basic ed, higher ed, tech voc, and ALS, and determine what the solutions are that can be systemic to improve learning.
Mm-hmm. EDCOM 2, that's an initiative. Who makes up EDCOM 2? What exactly are the KPIs that we're expecting from that?
So the EDCOM 2 is really a congressional, it's a comprehensive national assessment of the education sector, and it's congressional in nature. So essentially, it will really create an advisory council, a legal advisory council, and a policy advisory council. And the role is really to look at what the gaps are and then recommend the solutions for all levels of education.
Mm-hmm. And the private sector, what role does the private sector have in EDCOM too?
So the private sector should have a seat at the table, because at the end of the day, you know, education shouldn't be just delivered by one member of the sector, right? Private sector really has a role in aligning and providing signals, integrating content, approaches, and direction of the education system. Because at the end of the day, we really want to make sure that learners are competent for the future workforce.
Justin, it's EDCOM 2. I assume there's an EDCOM 1. What happened to that? What was the impact of that first round?
So, the EDCOM 1 was done in the early 90s, I think 1994, and it was a review also of the education system. In fact, it was that that created the DepEd and the TESDA and the CHED. If you remember, we were under one department, which was the Department of Education, Culture, and Sports.
Mm-hmm. I see. All right. Let's talk about the preparedness of schools, not just of kids. Let's talk about, you know, especially where there are more dropouts, certain schools, you know, that if they were in the private sector, they would have failed. And nobody would send their kids in these kinds of schools because it just doesn't work, and yet these schools don't fail. How do we deal with those kinds of schools that somehow keep on going without any correction, producing underperforming students and eventually underperforming graduates?
So what we're seeing is that schools are really performing poorly because they're not getting enough resources. Teachers are also not getting enough support. So currently, the Philippine government spends about 3% of its GDP in the education sector, which is really low compared to the global standard of 6%. So what we are really pushing for is public-private complementarity and decentralization of education service delivery. We have about 28 million students, 80% of which are in the public schools. So while, you know, we can say that, and or we can blame schools for saying, okay, you're not delivering, but the question is really, how do we help them? Or how do we create this system where we can bring in other players to effectively deliver education? So we see that private education is largely underutilized in terms of education delivery. Government can actually tap capital investments because these schools are already in place, right? So, for example, student subsidies or vouchers can be given even at the pre-primary and kinder level so that children can access private institutions or can access schools where public facilities might not be available.
Let's talk about these resources and some of the tools that we can tap to supercharge the education sector. What are some of the innovations in this space, the new technology that maybe can help us leapfrog from where we are now to top-notch, to quality education?
Of course, the technology is really, you know, the technology, when done right and used well, can supercharge education. So one of the insights that we got from the Global Education Evidence Advisory Panel, so it's an independent cross-disciplinary body, is that when it comes to learning, technology isn't a one cure for all. You can't provide a tablet or internet and say, okay, go learn. And so the evidence is really clear that if we provide devices and if we provide technology, there has to be support. Otherwise, without the right support, this will not have impact on learning. So if I may cite our experience in the project Kiddy Learning Train, where we provided tablets and a game-based learning platform called KitKit School. So we provided these to grade one students, and we saw that their literacy improved by 122%. Their numeracy skills improved by 20%. But the core here, or a key factor here, was actually that there were volunteer tutors with education background. So going back to what I was saying, it's not really enough that you just give something or you just give technology, but you really have to harness the power of other resources that are existing.
I was going to say, you know, that it's not just all about tech. I mean, just think about, I can imagine the Waldorf teaching philosophy, non-tech schools, where tech titans ironically send their kids to. These kids are supposed to have less screen time, more engaging the head, the heart, and the hands, focusing on thinking, feeling, and doing. Do you think this model works? Does this model still work in specific situations, the non-tech sort of education, leaving technology out of it?
Well, if you think about it, a lot of the things that you know, going into the workplace or becoming successful as someone, as an adult, you don't just need technical skills, right? You need your life skills. You need critical thinking. You need to be able to navigate the complexities of dealing with other people and solving problems. And these things you just don't learn through a screen. It really involves constant interaction with people, being in situations where you're forced to really think. So we do believe that these things have to be taken into account when, you know, teaching is done.
And how is the fight to make sure, you know, resources are available? I mean, is the Philippine education ill-prepared? Or do we find ourselves still caught fighting the last war, which is trying to get hold of quality textbooks to enough kids? And now we have to fight as well to get tablets and technology to them.
Sadly, learning inputs remain inadequate because, as what I mentioned earlier, we're really not getting the right budget or enough budget for education. That this is why we implore our current administration to really invest in our learners. And as they draw out their all-inclusive economic plan and, you know, they plan for the next 6 years, we really hope that they put education in the forefront and see this as a basic foundation for economic transformation. Also, at the same time, this would be a good opportunity for local governments and local government leaders to also rethink and, you know, prioritize education at the LGU level.
Justin, very quickly, the Vice President Sara Duterte is taking over the education portfolio. Have you gotten in touch with her team or with the Vice President herself?
Yes, so we've actually met her with a group of other education experts, and we presented our views and our proposed reforms. We saw her to be quite open, and we're glad about that. we really hope that the vice president could use her influence in putting education in the forefront and pushing for education as a priority of the national government. And also, secondly, what I really found interesting and hopeful was that she earlier mentioned the successes of Davao being attributing the successes of Davao to the partnership and consultation with the private sector. Mm-hmm. So us being private sector advocates for education, we really do hope that she can continue the work now at the national level and the level and the bigger space. And we really hope that she can work with us, especially in the work we do in convening, pushing for the convening of the EDCOM.
Yeah, EDCOM 2, that is. Two major issues now facing DepEd would be the National Department of Education would be a complete face-to-face for all students by November. Hopefully the COVID surge does not get in the way of that. And here's the more important question I wanted to get your take on. K-12. Some are pushing for a rethink of K-12. Some are saying you're adding two extra years to education of kids, which means more expenses for the parents who probably already cannot afford the basic education. But then there's no impact. The kids are still unprepared for these jobs. What do you think? From the private sector, do you think it's time to get rid or to scrap K-12 and go back to what it was before?
So you used the word rethink, but I'd like, and from PBED, we really would, we think that there has to be a review. It is true that, you know, things need to be reviewed in order to strengthen or to strengthen something, right? So for the K-12 system, for example, we believe that it has to be strengthened, and the whole education system should really be designed in a way that it addresses the learning crisis that I mentioned. And this review should really include not just, you know, the education sector, but really also members of business, because they're the ones who hire K-12 graduates who look for employment. Eventually, civil society. So this review should be a multi-sectoral approach. But what we've been seeing, so while it does add two additional years to education, we've been seeing these gains. Even so, before the pandemic, for example, we ran a project where we socialized the K-12 graduates to private sector. And what we saw was that in the first and second year of senior high school graduates entering the workforce, we saw the interest and the openness of private sector to hire them jump from 25% to 60%. Wow. So initially, before there were senior high school graduates, what we saw was that companies were very hesitant. They weren't really sure if, you know, these graduates would have the competencies. But once these graduates started entering the workforce, companies were actually saying, oh, they actually meet the competencies of entry of people, the competencies of entry-level jobs.
So it's not all that bad. There's also some good gains from there. It just needs to be reviewed.
Correct. And let's not forget that in the past 2 years there was also the pandemic. Yes. So you also can't really attribute they're not able to find jobs because they're just K-12 graduates. There are also other external factors that led to the difficulty of finding work.
All right, that's a fair point. Thank you very much, Justin, for joining us this morning for the insights and for the work that you do for our students. Thank you.
Thank you very much for having us.